his meditation manual, Love Beyond God, my colleague, the Reverend Adam Lawrence Dyer, describes what he calls the nod. It is the public but almost imperceptible acknowledgement that African American men have learned to give each other. Reverend Dyer says he was taught the practice by his father and uncles and grandfathers very early in life. What it signaled to both him and them was this affirming message. We are valid. We are real. We have a place. We have a family trying to live as part of this grand experiment called America. Once, as a teenager, he neglected to nod at another Black male on his path. From behind, he heard that man telling him, "Don't you ever forget, I'm all you've got." Ever since, Reverend Dyer has not forgotten. This customary observance seems to me as much spiritual as social. It bears witness to the inherent dignity of every individual and refutes any denial of the same, especially any denial here and now in this country of ours. Reverend Dyer laments that this practice of the nod seems to be fading away and notes that the trend is generational, with younger Black men neglecting it more and more. My God, he thinks, we don't recognize each other. Maybe we aren't teaching them that the struggle isn't over. The time hasn't healed a wound that opens over and over again, he worries. That wound is gaping this year, as we see so clearly our national failure to demonstrate that Black lives matter, that they have always mattered and always will. Continued civil unrest testifies to the sad fact. This June, after the tragic murder of George Floyd, we passed a congregational resolution to deepen our commitment to anti-racist work at UU Wellesley Hills. We are rather early on in this process, but we have done some advanced work in proclaiming, as Unitarian Universalists, that the inherent worth and dignity of every person is a foundational article of our faith. A little later this week, members of our Social Action Council, who have for years sponsored and coordinated the monthly Black Lives Matter vigil, will join me in facilitating an online book discussion of our 2020 Common Read, Ibram X. Kendi's bestseller, How to Be an Anti-Racist. In his book, Dr. Kendi contends that being an anti-racist means confronting not just attitudes and ideas, but practices and policies as well. Americans have long been trained to see the deficiencies of people rather than policies. It's pretty easy a mistake to make. People are in our faces, policies are distant, he writes. One either believes problems are rooted in groups of people as a racist, or locates the roots of problems in power and politics as an anti-racist. What he contends seems so obvious. People are not problems. People have problems. Why are we so prone to forgetting that? In America, Black people have a whole host of problems that white Americans have yet to frankly address. That needs to change for all our sakes, because basic human dignity is at stake. Growing up the son of two pastor parents, Dr. Kendi was raised with a progressive gospel rooted in Black liberation theology that held forth a vision of freedom and flourishing for communities of color. Yet even as early as age 7, he reports, I began to feel the encroaching fog of racism overtaking my dark body. It felt big, bigger than me, bigger than my parents or anything in the world, and threatening. What a powerful construction race is. It's powerful enough to preclude possibility and thwart potential. These days, we see that it is actually lethal, as minorities in the US are dying from the coronavirus at disproportionately high rates. That is true for both children and adults. This pandemic has worsened the widespread dis-ease of systemic racism and called our attention to the serious consequences of the chronic stressors that people of color are subjected to everywhere. We Americans declare our love of liberty, but we should love dignity in equal measure. It is the exact thing that endows us with inalienable rights. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights states that the recognition of the inherent dignity and of the equal rights of all members of the human family is the foundation of freedom, justice, and peace in the world. All human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. But to be Black in America is to have your dignity called into question almost constantly, and to feel compelled somehow to answer questions that no one has the right to ask. Dr. Kendi reports, "I felt the burden my whole Black life to be perfect both before white people and the Black people judging whether I was representing the race well. His entire life, racism threatened to erase his individuality, to tell him both who he was and who he could be. Adopting an anti-racist framework gave him the lexicon he needed to draft an alternate script, to have a story all his own to tell the world, a tale at once dignified and dignifying. His own personal journey toward anti-racism gave him permission and encouragement to evolve his beliefs. He started to question whether he and his friends would inevitably become the thugs that frequent news reports and gangster rap songs said they would be. He stopped seeing his peers as predators and himself as their prey. He stopped mistrusting the people who resembled him and whom he resembled." In his book, Dr. Kendi quotes Martin Luther King Jr. in telling a 1967 audience, "We must no longer be ashamed of being Black. As long as the mind is enslaved, the body can never be free." As Dr. Kendi freed himself from oppressive and dehumanizing master narratives about his own experience, he recognized how strong a hold they had on successive generations of Black Americans. He became determined to break their hold on future generations, beginning with the Black children and youth of today, born free and equal, as we know, in worth and dignity. This summer, Dr. Kendi moved to Massachusetts to assume the position of director of the new Center for Anti-Racist Research at Boston University. His anti-racist research began first as an inquiry into his own life and the lives of those closest to him. For him, fleshing out the human costs of racist practice is crucial. The African-American experience is not a footnote to American history. It is integral and formative of America itself, because history is constituted from all of our stories. We have to connect with each other more immediately and intimately across all racial divides and disparities erected over centuries of slavery and segregation in order to tell our whole truth, the healing truth. 40 years ago, the novelist Kurt Vonnegut told a UU audience at the First Parish in Cambridge, Massachusetts, "Dignity is something human beings give to each other." Knowing that the First Parish in Cambridge is where Reverend Dyer now serves as a UU minister, I question that statement. Dignity is actually something every human being is due. We have no right whatsoever to deny another's dignity. It's nothing we are free to take from one another, because dignity itself is the given. Anytime we allow other people's dignity to be assailed, we degrade our own. We fail to recognize our place in the human family, and we neglect our universal birthright. We owe each other much more than a nod. We owe each other our full regard. Like Dr. Kendi, Reverend Dyer has, as a Black man, been pressed down, shot at, torn apart, stolen from, talked about and not to, he complains, criminalized and caricatured. Sharing the honest experiences of his family and community provides Reverend Dyer a corrective to those stereotypical stories that threaten to circumscribe or even curtail his life. Both he and Dr. Kendi are working to spread a gospel of liberation. Remember, The gospel is not good news because it tells a neat tale or articulates a shared aspiration. Rather, it is the gospel precisely because it is true about the human condition. The good news is that racist and anti-racist are not fixed identities, Dr. Kendi declares in his book. A racist institution or city or state can become more anti-racist simply by acknowledging that racism is endemic and damaging. We should not expect African Americans to tolerate schooling or wages or policing or housing or legal remedies or public treatment or social attitudes or medical care or unequal outcomes that are unworthy of them and indeed beneath their dignity. As we deepen our anti-racist commitments here at UU Wellesley Hills, we will come to challenge glaring disparities more readily. Our fellow Americans are all we've got. When will we finally realize that? Of course they are valid and they are real. They have a place in the human family and in this country too. Black lives do matter tremendously. Witnessing to that must become a spiritual imperative for each of us now.